All right. Yeah. Hope y'all enjoyed the video. Did y'all enjoy it?
Yeah.
Two people enjoyed it? I think, did the people over here enjoy it?
Okay.
Cool. I'm glad. See, that's what we did. We really tricked you guys, you know, put some food in your bellies. You know what I'm saying? Put everybody in a good mood, put a video on. Yeah, that warms everybody up, man. So I'm excited to be here today. I'm thankful that you guys are here to join us. And man, it's been an incredible journey. As the video said, the journey still continues. And I'm very thankful to have my teammates here today. Very thankful to have my coach here today. This is the man that I started with, my uncle. He read an article in the newspaper. He was starting a weightlifting development center for children, you know. And when he saw that newspaper article, he thought it would be a good idea for us to learn how to do some weightlifting and be supervised. We were playing other sports, spar and whatnot, and you know, they got co-ed softball, basketball, all these different sports, football. And when he saw this in the newspaper, he thought this was really unique. And that's when I got to meet Dr. Kyle Pierce. He's one of the first people outside of my family that told me that I could see the world, you know. And me being from Stoner Hill, I was crazy enough to believe him. I was like, all right, so if I come in here, you know, if I pick this bar up, I can go and see the world. So, man, he's one of those first people, like I said, outside of my family that put that inside of me. So that inception, man, it was great for me. So, like I said, after the 1996 Olympics, they started 12 satellite programs around the United States. And we ended up getting one here in Shreveport, Louisiana. That's the Weightlifting Development Center that we still have. It's right over here on this campus. So if you went in the physical education building, we have our gym there. That's our program, free for children. Sign up for your membership and you can come learn how to lift. And perfect. It was perfect for me, you know, and at the right time. My parents, they had just gotten separated, you know, in the midst of going through a divorce. So it's like I needed an outlet. I'm thankful that, you know, I had my uncle who was always taking us to football games, always making sure that we were involved in other different things. So for them to start the program here and for it to be free for children was huge for me. So being able to come in, learn how to do the movements a couple of times a week, I was like, okay, this could be something that I could really get into, man, because I always been competitive. I always wanted to win, but the only thing that I had a crazy attitude, you know, my temper would just go off the meters. So for me to get involved in this sport and kind of be able to put my energy into something positive was great for me. And like I said, hearing from someone outside of my family that told me that I can see the world, if I stuck to it, set goals for myself, like I said, I believed it. And being able to go to my first Junior Olympic competition, it was in Virginia Beach, Virginia. I believe it was the summer of 1998, And I won that competition, won gold medal at my first Junior Olympic competition. Now, I was the only one in my weight class. I was the only one in it. You got to let that sink in. I was the only one. So I was at just the right amount of weight to where I was like, okay. So I'm talking to my coach, talking to my uncle. I said, so I can go out and just lift the bar and I'll win, right? And he was like, yeah, you can do that, but that's not what we're gonna do. We're gonna stick to the plan. And that's what we've been doing ever since. You know, I've had some moments where I may have strayed away from the plan that we have set. But you have to understand, in order to achieve any goal that you have set, man, you really, really have to truly believe in it. It's one thing that we can say, okay, I want to go to the Olympics. That sounds like a wish. In order for it to be a goal, something attainable, now we have to put a plan in order, and then we have to stick to it. Like I mentioned in the video, it's actually a quote that I got from Dr. Pierce. I don't know if he got it from someplace else, but your behavior has to line up with your goals. So if I say I'm going to the Olympics, can't be out in the streets hanging out all night, can't be partying all the time, can't be skipping workouts, and when I'm coming to the workout, I can't be not giving 100% effort, you know. So your behavior has a line up with your goals if you want to be able to achieve it. So moving forward from that first competition and winning that thing, I'm really excited. I remember I'm being 14, I was talking to one of my English teachers at Byrd, and I was like, it was 2000. I said, you know what? The next Olympics is gonna be in Sydney, Australia. I said, I'm gonna be on that team. I mean, I'm fired up. She's like, okay, you just need to be quiet and just do your work. You know what I'm saying? You're talking about the Olympics. You need to just focus right now. So 2004 rolls around. You know, I'm graduating high school, and all of a sudden, you know, the Olympic trials are on us. I didn't even qualify for the tryout to go and try out for the Olympics. So that was eye-opening for me. I was like, so you don't just go? I was like, they don't just take you because it's the Olympics and you do this sport. You can't just show up and go? He's like, nah, that's not how it works. I remember talking to my coach. I don't know if he remembers this. We was in his office, and I was looking at the list because you had to be ranked top 25 in the nation in order to get the invitation to go to the Olympic trials. And I was like, well can I just go? And he was like, don't worry about that. You don't need to worry about that. You need to focus, and we just need to train. So I remember I was working at a restaurant that summer. I was actually working at Copeland's right down the street. I was bussing tables. Right? And this is what's crazy. I don't recall seeing the Olympics when I was younger on television. I mean, seeing weightlifting on TV when they had the Olympics. I don't recall seeing this when I was younger, unless I was just so focused on the basketball and the swimming and track and field. But that's all I remember seeing. So I'm working at Copeland's at this time. And I remember my coworkers called me over. They said, Kendrick, they said, isn't this what you do? And I look up, it's weightlifting on TV. It's my weight category, everything. And I'm like, I'm just blown away at that moment. I'm like, yeah, man, I'm gonna be on the next Olympic team. It just got quiet. I said, oh my goodness. They was like, man, you need to go bust some tables. They need you over there. Need you over there in section 3. We ain't got time for you to be in here dreaming, brother. You need to clean them tables over there and roll some silverware while you're at it. So I remember it was dead quiet. And I said, okay, I probably don't need to be here. This is a lot of unbelief going on. You know when you just say something and then you can just feel it, like you feel like you said something wrong. I was like, I'm not saying anything wrong because I believe in this. You know what I'm saying? I got people that believe in me as well. So I ended up quitting that job. 2 years later, 2006, my son, he was born. My first son, my oldest son. And I knew at that moment, I was like, man, this is real life now. I really got to get serious. Like I was already, you know, training really hard, winning competitions, kind of making a name for myself, building some momentum. But I remember when he was born, I was like, okay, so now it's not just myself. Now I can work hard and do something and make someone else proud of me. And it's my own, you know, it's my son. So that gave me some extra motivation just to move forward and keep going. So 2008 rolls around and I end up making my first Olympic team. And man, I'm just riding the wave. I said, man, yeah, this is what it's about. And I remember just putting all of my energy into making the team. And then all of a sudden I decided, I was like, oh man, I want to win an Olympic game. That's what I want to do. And I thought that would just be the greatest thing if I could just go to an international meet and win a gold medal. I think that would just make everyone proud, whatever the case is. And I remember in 2010, I actually got to win my first senior international competition, the Pan Am Championships. We were down in Guatemala, and I won gold at that competition. And the one thing that really came to my mind, I remember they playing the national anthem, and what I was thinking about is, okay, I got it now. So now what? Even in that moment, is what I was thinking. I was proud, and it was a great competition. I remember looking down in the right hand corner. I could see my coach. I could tell that he was proud. We just, man, just a lot of ups and downs that we've had, and always keeping our eye on the big picture. You know, and who you're gonna be as a person. All these things were just coming to mind. So I'm like, man, how can I affect some people? Like, what's gonna be real? And man, just life-changing things started happening from there. 2011, I ended up getting married to my wife. So now we're building and whatnot. And I'm like, man, I gotta do something. Wanted to do more things in a community. You know what I mean? Being committed to the people that I grew up to. Wanted to be more hands-on in the gym and not in the sense of taking my focus away from training, but making sure that I'm creating an environment that's gonna be conducive for everyone to come in and say, hey, if this is what your goal is, I wanna make sure that you believe in it as well, because if you're speaking it, I want you to believe it. So I wanna encourage you. I'm like, hey man, I've had some ups and downs, but I set goals to myself and I believe that it can happen. This is what I've been through. This is what I'm doing right now. So man, it was just incredible for me to actually start seeing some things happening and then just keep pushing forward. So at this point right now, 3-time Olympian. So I made the Olympic team in 2008. That was my first one. My second Olympic team in 2012, it was held in London, and then the one that we just had in Rio. So, and I'm thinking, so, okay, you have these accolades, or, you know, you've been able to set these goals for yourself. So what's next? So what can we do to take everything to another level? And I feel like that is what it's all about. It's so important that we believe in ourselves and we believe in what we're doing, but also how can you make that a domino effect to the people that are around you? And the best thing you can do is truly be committed to yourself. I don't want you to make you think I'm saying be selfish, but you have to truly focus on yourself. That's the only way that we can create any type of change. Some change is gonna be everlasting. You understand what I'm saying? So if I have a goal set for myself and someone around me sees that I'm really working hard, hopefully that would inspire them to do the same thing. And if we're committed to ourselves, hopefully that would show you how you can be committed to someone else. So the way we're treating one another is obviously it's a direct reflection of how we feel about ourselves. So we have to take time and just really think about that and understand how important it is to have a goal. I know I keep saying that word goal. I really wanted to just nail in on you guys' mind because it's so important. Things that we say we want to do, it's a new year, say, you know what? I want to start eating healthier. And it's a change that I made in 2014, right when my second son was born. I was like, you know what? I want to just try to get back to just the purest form. My wife, she was pregnant. I'm reading all these different books. And, you know, we were getting these email updates on the baby, like the development of the child. And he was a peanut baby. Then all of a sudden, he's a melon baby. Now he's giving all these different things. So I was like, okay, cool. I'm reading the books. I'm like, so this is what I want to do. I want to start with the food. So I what's crazy is I don't think my coach ever said anything to me about changing the diet. He never said anything. I know he was worried though. He had to be worried because when people hear like you're not eating any meat, their mind just like, so what are you eating? It was like they thought it was just gonna wither away. You know what I'm saying? So I made that change because I just wanted to be a lot more healthier. So hopefully you guys got a chance to get a little bit of that food over there, and it's something I want you guys to implement into your diet. Why? Why do I want you to do that? Man, number one, you'll be able to think a lot clearer. Going from there, you'll be able to sleep a lot better. Sleeping a lot better, you have a lot more energy. Your body will be functioning the way it's supposed to. If you're thinking more clearly, you have more energy, it's like your whole demeanor, your whole attitude, everything changes. So it makes it a lot more, you're not focusing on a lot of, I guess you can say, external things that can like pull you away from goals that you have set or how you're actually treating the people that are around you. So it's very important that we can be very clear on these things. So, man, the first thing, if you can just start with the food, I wish I knew these things some years ago, but I know I got these things at the moment, and I feel like that's what my bigger purpose is, you know, had the opportunity to make all these different teams, meet a lot of different people, and, man, hopefully I can just impart my words and my story on people, and you guys are inspired by it, you know, to want to, like I said, spark some change in yourself. So, man, right now, what I really would like to do is open the floor for any questions that we may have, any questions that someone has, and I don't want to force anybody, but if you're thinking anything, you most ever can ask. Yes, ma'am.
Did your wife embrace the vegan diet?
So, this is perfect. So, look, when I first told my wife, she laughed in my face. No lie, I said, baby, this is what I'm going to do. Because she knows I'm always reading this different stuff, and I'm like, hey, did you know this? So look, I said, all right, baby, so this is what I'm going to do. Look, I'm not going to eat any more meat. I said, man, and I said, look, let's cut out the dairy. I like, when we can slowly start doing it, this is what we're going to do. And then she just started laughing. She was like, you like burgers and stuff. What are you talking about? Because I still do to this day, but now we just switched up the ingredients. So when I told her, man, it was crazy, man. She laughed at me, but now she's actually on board. She's cut out so many different things. And for me personally, I understand it's a journey for everyone. So I'm not saying, hey, go cold turkey. I was able to do that, you know, but for a lot of people, it's a process. So that's why I'm like, if you can implement a few of these different recipes into your diet, you're gonna get a craving to wanna eat like this because you're gonna see the change that you have. I can eat so much food now and I don't get tired. So I used to not even eat before I went to train because I didn't wanna be tired when I went to the gym. Now I can eat a lot and I feel like I have a lot of energy, right? So that was the initial reaction. You know, so now, like I said, she eats a lot of the meals with me. She was doing it, but it was at one point in time just cooking my little meals over here. Now she's like, nah. She's in there chef, she's chefing it up. So it's cool, man, it's pretty cool.
Kendrick, tell them how many people were with you on the U.S. team, males, this year, representing the United States,
and they were respected. Okay, so out of all the lifters that we have in the United States, I was the only male represented to lift in the Olympics in 2012 and for this past Olympic Games.
Did you hear that?
Yeah, you tell them again. Like tell them, Clark.
Like you
come on.
Where you got to go and be stupid at the gas station and still have a few left over.
Yeah, no. No.
You've got here one Olympian representing the United States of America.
Yes.
One male representing the United States. How many times did you do that?
Twice. I did it twice.
Twice.
So if I was being stupid at a gas station.
We didn't have very good system here. I don't know if it said that.
Bring it up.
But I got to tell you, that is amazing.
Thank you.
That is amazing.
Thank you so much. For real. So just like Mr. Clark said, if they'd have kicked me out for the gas station thing, the whole team would have been gone. It'd have just been myself.
What changes did you notice when you embraced the vegan diet?
Yes, ma'am. So when I started implementing like some of these plant-based recipes, I just noticed like when my sleep, I was hitting like deep realms of sleep. So for example, if I take like a 30-minute nap, I mean, it feels like I've been out and I feel just recharged, like just ready to go. I don't feel like all groggy or anything. I really didn't have an issue with, like I said, with the amount of sleep that I was getting. But now, I mean, if I get like 4 hours of sleep, I'm ready to go. Like, that's all I need. So more energy, my body recovering a lot faster. It was just amazing to me, you know, just to be able to go in the gym, you know, do what I normally do. And then knowing for sure the food that I'm going to eat, I'm going to get max sleep, max recovery, and be able to go in the gym and do exactly what I need to do. So these things, if it's, I feel like if it's working for me, like in the training and the fire that I'm putting myself through just in normal life, like, man, I think it'll be phenomenal for people just to test it out. Slide, like I said, look up Google, whatever you need to do, slide a couple of those meals in there. And I really think it'll help. So you guys have got a little taste here tonight. We got Remarkable Foods here. So if you guys haven't grabbed Mark's card, make sure you do that. Yes, sir. So this is a recipe that Brother Mark, that he put together. So we just kind of collabed on it. We actually did like this little cooking show a little while back, and we were just kind of messing around. He put the ideas together. I can't take credit for it. It's just something that I really liked. He was like, this is what we're going to do. I was like, man, that's perfect. It tastes awesome. So all Remarkable Food. Yeah. I just kind of put my stamp on. I'm like, I like this, bro. This is good. Yes, ma'am. So people ask about that a lot, like with the protein, I'm not gonna say that it's not important, but it's almost like a myth, because let's say if you're taking in 60 grams of protein, like how much is your body actually retaining? That's a question like most people, they don't even know. They're like, I don't know. Most of it, you're just kind of casting right out of your body. So I think what's really important is to make sure that you're not hungry, that your body is like not feeling like you're starving. You see what I'm saying? So if you're eating enough food and your body feels satisfied, that's a clear indicator, like, okay, this is enough food. But the protein, I mean, you really only need very little. You know what I'm saying? You don't need 100 grams of protein a day, or you don't need 60 grams of protein. Because I think on average with the meals that I was doing, I was getting somewhere between maybe 20 and 25 grams of protein. Yes, ma'am.
How does it feel? You're the only American. What does that begin to represent for you?
No, see.
When does that? When you're there at the Olympics, the first time, was it more meaningful? The first time you're the only American, the second time the only American. Mm-hmm. That's an incredible story.
Honestly, like my mindset on it has always been really just how I can affect people. That's all I think about. I don't think, well, I'm the only one and like boastful. No, I just look at it like I feel like I worked really hard. I've had good people around me, and then, you know, things just worked out the way that we had planned. And it just kind of gives me I guess it just kind of highlights what I'm doing.
Pictures in a lot of gyms around this country and around the world.
It's a lot of places, and I think
Glossy's out there.
Yeah, but see, it just helps when people come in. Now I can just kind of just talk to people. It's an easy icebreaker. I don't look at it like, you know, like on a boastful type thing. You know, I'm humbled by it. Like I said, I worked hard, and I just kind of position myself to where things can kind of work out in my favor. So I'm thankful. But like I said, it just goes back to that defining moment that I had in 2011. Like I said, I won that medal. I was up there, and then I was thinking, okay, so now what? You know, I need to always be thinking of different ways that I can better myself, and that's the first thing that comes to my mind. I'm like, okay, what am I doing? Am I a reflection of the amount of work that I've put in? Do you see what I'm saying? Because I don't think it would matter if any of you guys came up to me and I was just like a jerk to you. You wouldn't care anything about that that's on the paper. You'd be like, I met him, but it was a waste. You almost feel like you didn't want to meet me. So I want people, when they meet me, they don't have to know anything about me going to the Olympics. I want them to feel me and understand, hey man, okay, that's a real individual right there. That's a person who understands life. That's a person who understands people and a lover of man. So I want people to know that I'm all about humanity, and I want people to really open their eyes to certain things that's going on. We don't have time to be boastful. Not where we are right now, you know. So we really have to encourage one another. Is very important.
Kyle,
so
what about your pride in what he's done? I mean, he came to you in the eighth grade?
Sixth grade. I was 11 years old.
Sixth grade.
Yep.
He's been in there almost 20 years.
Almost 20 years, yeah. My whole life has been one workout. when I went in the gym, I was 11 years old. I came out, I got a wife and some kids. I was like, I said, where did y'all come from? I said, my mama just dropped me off, so I don't know what's going on.
He was also, Kendrick won the summer before last. They always have the Pan American Games. Mm-hmm. It's a multi-sport event every 4 years. He's been in three of them. He didn't medal the first time in Rio, and then he got a bronze medal in Guadalajara, and he was the gold medalist at the Toronto Pan American Games for weightlifting. I believe that was the first gold medal for the U.S. in the Pan American Games in weightlifting.
Long time.
In over 10 years.
Yes, 2003.
He's reigning, and he won the Pan Am Championships for the second time, so he's three-time Pan American champion in his weight category for this hemisphere here, the best in his weight category. But the best thing is rewarding, as with all the kids, to see them do well in weightlifting, but it's also even more rewarding to see them grow as students and as people and citizens in the community.
Very, very important. I got you, then I got my man right here, then I got you, Mr. Hubbard. Bring it out. Okay, so we started a co-drive in 2014. The footage that you guys saw in that video, it was from that year, and it's something that we've been trying to do every year. So we have, and because, man, we're giving out clothes and we do things with feeding people just throughout the year. So I think it's just so important. Man, if you go look in your closet, this was what dawned on me and how it all started. It's like, looked in my closet, and then I had a couple of things still had tags on. What am I doing? You know what I'm saying? I'm like, why do I have this stuff? So let me get some things together. And I started going, you know, giving clothes and we put little care packages together for people. I said, okay, so this is something I want to do in my neighborhood. I can do it all the time, especially this time of the year. Let me bring it and, you know, what we can have, like I said, that domino effect. So that's how that all started. I'm pretty sure you guys can do the same thing. Go home, look, you got a whole bunch of coats or a whole bunch of shoes. There's a lot of people out here, man, they don't have it. And if we're just looking at them like, they did something wrong, or we have to understand, man, it could easily be us in that position, because a lot of people don't have family, they have a lot of people around them. So a couple of mistakes from a person, man, they can be living out there and not have anything. And then we got certain people that are living in like inner city neighborhoods. It's just not enough. So we have more than enough to give back. Like I said, I grew up that way, not having much. So now that I got a little bit, I'm like, I don't need it. I can wear this every day. I can go home, I can wash it, put it right back on, but I got options where I can go through clothes. Some people don't have that. So that was my mindset behind it. I'm like, let's make sure, man, we give back because we can. Right here, yes, sir.
Slide says the journey continues.
Yes, sir.
So
that's the plan. So my mindset, man, is really just to, I just started training. I don't even want to say training. Just got back in the gym a couple weeks ago. Look, he's ready. Look, just got back in the gym a couple weeks ago, and I'm trying to just get things snowballing so I can build up. But that is the plan, to get back in shape and so I can be competitive these next few years that's coming up. So we'll see. Tokyo, man, I think it'd be nice. Yes, sir. Mr. Hubbard, don't forget now. Bring it up.
Olympic trials 2016.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Take us through the minutes, seconds before that. You got to go in with some level of confidence, but what put you in that mindset?
It stemmed from something that happened really from when I was a child. And I'm not going to be too long with this because I can go in a whole circle. Me and my cousin, we would always like compete against each other. I told you guys I had a really bad temper. So it's like if I couldn't win in whatever game we was playing, then we had to fight. Like I got to win in something, right? We're going to do something. But I remember my cousin, he would always beat me. Like I used to like Chicago Bulls, Michael Jordan. He liked Akeem Olajuwon. He would always do the little shake and make the basket on me. I couldn't stop him. So I'm like, you know what? When I get an opportunity to take the last shot, I want to be able to make it and win. And I remember in 2012, in order for me to win my session, I needed to make the last lift. I missed it. So 2013 comes around, we were in Russia, in Kazan. I needed to make my last lift in order to medal. Made it. So really moving forward from 2012, because it actually reminded me of what happened. You know what I'm saying? When I was younger, I'm thinking about Darrell. So I'm like, okay, moving forward. We come to 2016. My mind is already on these things. I'm like, if it comes down to the last lift and the way we actually had it planned, that's how we had it scripted. I kid you not. So when the opportunity was there, I was like, I'm ready. I'm not second guessing. I'm like, this is what we're here for. This is what we're training for. So let's go out and do it. And I set these moments up in training as well. I may not like announce it. I don't say, hey, everybody, if I miss this lift, then it means no. But in my mind, I'm like, I need to make this. So that's really how it all started. Yeah, wanting to have that pressure and then to be able to come through. Yes, sir.
So when you're
bring it up.
At the very Yes. And you're squatting and you've got your, what's going on through your head?
So my focus there is always to execute the movement. Because if I'm thinking about anything that's external, then I'm off of it. If I'm like, okay, this is such and such amount of weight on the bar, how is it gonna feel? I don't think about that. I'm aware, like I know what's on the bar, I know what's at stake, but you still have to go through and execute the movement. Like I don't have to say, okay, what do I need to do now? If I'm doing a snatch, is one of the lifts that we do, and another one is a clean and jerk. I have to focus on that particular movement at that moment. So that's what my mindset is always on. Once I get down, I get set, I'm just thinking to execute. And for me, what that means is I understand how to do the movement. I know how my body works, so I have to trust in that. So that's what I was just trying to keep on, you know what I'm saying, just the front of my mind. Even if I'm taking a weight that I've never taken before, like I don't have to say, well, how am I gonna make this work? Well, it's the same way I did on the previous lifts, whatever got me to that point. Yes, ma'am. And then I got you. The most weight I've ever lifted, like in a competition lift or just?
So
the most weight I've lifted from the floor and then going overhead with it, I think is around 475 pounds. Yes, ma'am. I think that's what it is. Yes. Oh, no, I appreciate it. I appreciate it. Yes, ma'am. So we, you know, you have about, in the Olympic Games, is most of the time it's at least 40 plus countries that are gonna be there competing. Each country obviously won't have an athlete in every category. So I think in my category, it was about, I think it was close to maybe 30 athletes, I believe. So that's what it is. Each team, you know, you can send a max of, you know, a person in each category. I think a full men's team is 6. Say again.
What are the categories?
Yeah, we do about weight categories. So the men, I think they have 7 categories. Women have 6, and everything is done by weight class.
So I could modify international standards. That's
yes.
Why there was only one American.
Yes.
The other weight classes didn't qualify like Kendrick did.
Yeah.
So it's not like most for the United States. You qualify within the United States for swimming, and then you go.
Yeah, no,
you
no,
have
no.
To
I didn't.
Qualify internationally to be able to represent a country. So it's a little different by how it works. That's why it's so unique the way it does.
At our world championships, each individual performance, it scores you team points. So they take the top 25 teams and then they give slots based on that. So 25 and up, you can have a max of maybe 3 to 5. So we finished 26 as a team, so we didn't qualify any spots. So that's why we had to go to the Pan Am Championships. We got a wild card spot and you know, I was a top ranked athlete. I scored the most points at our Pan Am Championships. So that's why I was selected to represent us in Rio. Yes, ma'am. So that's how it works. There's a lot of little moving parts going on.
Are there any others in this area that do the weightlifting?
Yes, ma'am. We have a program. You know, so these individuals sitting at the table right here, I train with them. She was like, oh, yeah, yeah. So I get to train with these individuals and like I said, a few other students and other people that we have that train here. They come in for training camps and whatnot. So just like I said, it's phenomenal, like what we have over here right here on campus. So like I said, the program is free for children. All I have to do is sign up for their weightlifting membership, USAW, and that's probably about $20 a year. You know, I think my membership is like $35 a year. So they do that, man. They can come right in, learn how to do the lifts, and hopefully, you know, start competing. I got you right. Bring it up, and I got you.
What made you change from the split jerk to the squat jerk?
Okay, so we got. If you looked at the video, seen the style while I was doing, like moving the feet. But if you notice when I was younger, like how I would kind of be on the screen and then all of a sudden I'm off of the screen. We learned how to do these 3 different styles, split jerk, a power jerk, and a squat jerk. Split jerk is the one where you're seeing the feet move. A power jerk, the feet they'll start here and then move a little bit wider. Squat jerk is when it's similar to a power jerk, but it's going all the way down. That's the one where you see me catch the weight and going all the way down and back up. And I was just trying to do what worked more naturally for me, you know, what I felt, was a more high percentage lift. So if you ever see in a competition, I can bring out all 3 of them, you know. So just try to do the one that's gonna be, you know, gonna work at that moment is always what I'm thinking. I just kind of base it how I feel, really. Yes, sir. Bring it out, sis.
What tips do you have for dealing with setbacks so you can focus?
Okay. So anytime I may have a setback. I always just try to go back to the goal, and I try to like just evaluate like what I'm doing. you know, and then if we need to make any adjustment, then you move forward. So, for example, if I say, hey, okay, I want to lose 10 pounds by the beginning of February, if it's a, or, you know, if it's the top of February, if I say I want to lose 10 pounds at the end of the month, and let's say you get 2 weeks in and you've only lost 2 pounds, you have to go back and say, okay, well, what have I been eating or what have I been drinking? These would be, it's important to document like exactly what you're doing to make sure that you are on track, because you can be doing something that's just totally counterproductive to the plan that you have. So anytime we have what we call setbacks or things are getting kind of stagnant, we have to evaluate what we're doing. And it may not be anything wrong with it, because if you're like, okay, I'm doing everything I'm supposed to be doing, what I may need to do is kind of push the timeline back a little bit. Maybe I was, you know, being a bit ambitious by saying I'm gonna be able to do it at this point in time, because I've had it done to myself when I say, hey, I want to make this amount of weight at this particular time, and like I said, the timetable come up, and I'm like, man, I'm not there, but I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. I mean, I may need to be a little bit more patient and just stick to what I've been doing, because it's not taking me off course, but it may just take a little bit longer. So that's what I always just try to keep in mind, making sure everything is on point. Yes, ma'am.
Ben, yes, sir. Athletes wanting to go vegan as far as,
yes, sir,
eating because of the benefits, the health benefits you get from it.
Yes, sir. I seen an article that they put together. The names are, the only names that's coming to my mind, I know Venus and Serena Williams, they started doing it, and it's a young lady. She was a partner. I don't know if you guys ever watched beach volleyball. So Carrie Walsh, her new partner, I forget the young lady's name, but she follows that plant-based diet. And it's another individual. I cannot think of the name, but it's a few different athletes that are actually, you know, implementing like some of the plant-based ingredients to their regimen. So, you get a lot of questions. You know, like I said, we're all trying to, you know, get better and learn as well and try to perfect what we're doing. Within the training program? I don't know. I've had a few people probably ask me, but I think everybody's got, look, they's like, no. They're like, nah, Kendrick. They're like, I'm good with that steak. Don't be trying to get me off of that. But no, but see, it's cool. My thing is like, I'm not trying to change anyone. You know what I'm saying? Really just share information. Because like I said, it is for everyone, but it may not be for everybody. You know what I'm saying? So I believe that it can work. But at the end of the day, people still have to do what works for them. Another interesting thing that I'm going to start researching is really just with the blood types and how the food actually affects it. And I know this is true. My sister-in-law, I found out like she follows a plant-based diet. Reason because, you know, she was telling about her blood type and how she feels when she eats certain foods. And then I met another individual when I was in New York telling me about a book that I should read. And I thought, I'm like, okay, cool. So I need to look more into it. So that's another interesting thing. If you know your blood type, like I say, you can Google this stuff and the reading material will come up, and then you can just kind of check it out yourself too. Yes, sir.
Understand why we're so proud of him?
I'm trying. No, but I appreciate y'all, man. Thank y'all so much, man, for just listening to me talk, because I don't want to keep going in circles, but thank y'all so much. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the food, enjoyed the message as well, because I'm excited to be here and share it with you guys. Thank y'all. Appreciate y'all. Appreciate you. Nah, you the man. You the man.
You're the man.
Nah, you the man.